Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Milan Květoň, and I'm from the Czech Technical University in Prague. And I would like to speak about new recording material with silver halide nanoparticles for optical holography. A short outline at the beginning. So at first, I would like to describe mechanisms of mass transport in photopolymers and in silver halide emulsions. It is necessary for understanding of our new concept of the new material. So then I want to describe photopolymers with nanoparticles in general, which are currently used for production of special photonic structures. And then I will introduce the concept of our new material. I will give some characteristics of it, and I will show some measurements. So at first, I'll start with the photopolymer. It is a volume phase recording medium. It is a self-developing medium. And in our optical physics group in Prague, we prepare our own photopolymers, such as acrylamide-based or photopolymers with epoxy matrix. We studied also the processes which are running during the exposure, and the basic composition of our materials is or they are composed of monomers, initiator, and polymer matrix. Before the exposure, the components are homogeneously dispersed in the layer. And when we expose the material with a harmonic interference field, we initiate in the bright areas of the interference field polymerization process. Polymer chains grow, and they consume monomers from the surrounding, and additional monomers diffuse from the dark areas of the interference field. So after the exposure, in the material is formed modulation of polymer density and hence refractive index grating. Mass transport occurs also in silver halide emulsion when the process, the rehalogenization process, is applied. In our university, we use our own silver halide emulsions, which are based on silver bromide grains. Their size is about 30 nanometers. And sometimes ago, we studied the mechanism of formation of a volume grating in these media. So at first, I would like to show you the developing process and scanning image of scanning electron microscope of the exposed and developed layer. So I don't know if you can see that there are two types of grains. In the green areas, there are smaller grains, which are more elliptical than in the other areas. And the smaller grains are the metallic silver after the development. And the rest is the circular grains is the original nanoparticles of silver bromide. So when when the developed material is bleached to form the face hologram, we can use for the bleaching process several techniques. The first two techniques, conventional and reverse bleaching, are, I would say, old-fashioned. Today, mainly the rehalogenization process is used. I will not go into details about these processes. I just will show the images from scanning electron microscope of conventional bleaching process and of the reverse bleaching process. In both cases, you can see some stripes in the medium, which means that some material was completely removed from from the layer. Here you can see the modulation of the density of nanoparticles. I would like to speak a little more about the process of rehalogenization bleach. The bleacher, when we bleach the emulsion, in fact, we convert the metallic silver back to silver bromide, but the process is a little bit complicated because there is a diffusion of the silver bromide to original silver bromide particles, which grows due to the affinity of the small grains to the bigger grains. So after the bleaching process, here you can see the layer, and in the exposed area, all the silver halide materials is completely removed. It is not removed. It is in fact moved to the non-illuminated areas of the interference field. We did some more measurements with scanning electron microscope, and before I showed you an overexposed material. In the overexposed material, the size of the grains increase very much. And if you compare it with this image, where the material was optimally exposed, you can see the difference between these grains and these grains. So the rehalogenization process is very effective, but it causes that the grains grow up. So we must carefully control the composition of the bleacher, of the exposure, and stuff like this. So we made also other measurements. Here in this picture is exposure of the material with different spatial period. We wanted to show that the transport of mass occurs also on longer distances, as you can see. So I will move on to photopolymers with nanoparticles, which is a subject of intensive study in the last 10 years. It is again a volume recording material, and this material combines properties of the periodic diffraction structures with special properties of nanoparticles, such as refractive index, absorption, luminescent properties, magnetic. And in these materials you can make very nice photonic structures such as lasers with distributed feedbacks, holographic sensors and others. Their composition is very similar to standard photopolymers, but nanoparticles are embedded. The recording mechanism in the first part is also similar, but when the polymer chains are formed in the bright areas of the interference field, the nanoparticles are extruded from these bright areas to the non-illuminated areas. It is due to the non-compatibility of polymers with nanoparticles. So in this way, the redistribution of nanoparticles is formed in the photopolymer recording materials with nanoparticles. So now I would like to introduce our concept. So the main idea is that we will combine the silver bromide nanoparticles in gelatin with a radical photopolymerization system. The silver bromide, pardon. The silver bromide nanoparticles we can prepare by standard method, and through the radical photopolymerization, which is inhomogeneous, we can make the redistribution of the nanoparticles within the layer. So the ED advantage of this material is that the silver bromide grains remain the same size during they remain the same size after the exposure. So it's different from the silver halide emulsion. We have designed such a chemical composition of the material. So we use the silver bromide nanoparticles, gelatin matrix, acrylic acid and dimethyl acrylamide monomers, and the radicals are formed through photoinitiator and co-initiator. The self-developing ability of photopolymers enable real-time detection of the formation process of a grating. We built for it such a setup. The beam from the laser is expanded through the spatial filter and collimated through the lens. One part of it goes directly through the material, and the other part is reflected by the mirror. In the place where both waves are overlapping, the sample of the photopolymer material is placed. So when we switch the exposure, we can continuously measure its diffraction efficiency with we use in this case collimated laser diodes, which is which wavelength is different from the absorbing wavelengths. So we built in our optical laboratory such a setup. It is a little bit more complicated than in the upper figure. And with the setup, we are able to obtain the dependence of the refractive index module of the diffraction efficiency on time. But the diffraction efficiency is good for characterization of holograms or diffraction gratings, but if you want to characterize the recording process, it's better to evaluate the parameter which is called refractive index modulation, and it is done with the well-known expression derived in the Kogelnik's coupled wave theory. So the dependence of the refractive index modulation on time we call Grove curve, and the advantage of the Grove curve is that it is thickness independent and angle independent. We use it for the characterization, and a typical Grove curve is given in this figure. There are several phases. The first one is a short induction period, then a grating start to grow. It goes through its inflection point, and when we switch off the exposure, there is some post-exposure growth, and after the post-exposure growth, there is a final period. In the final period, usually the efficiency or the refractive index modulation remains stable, or it can decrease due to some degradation processes. So such a curve, or the course of the curve, depends on many parameters, let's say exposure parameters like intensity, exposure time, spatial period of the interference field and others, and also on the chemical composition. For the photopolymer with nanoparticles, I have measured several dependencies. In the first figure, there is influence of different recording intensity, and in the second, there is influence of different spatial period. So what can we say from these measurements? That it's better to expose the materials with higher recording intensity, and the material is not very good so far for short spatial period. And these facts are due to the polymerization system. So we would like to optimize it to obtain some better results. However, we did some measurements with a scanning electron microscope, and I hope you can see that there are fringes of the refractive index grating. I have to explain it. This is a piece of glass, this is the recording layer, and these stripes is the refractive index grating. And if we magnify the layer, we can clearly see that there is the redistribution of nanoparticles. So in the presentation, I wanted to explain you how to holographically move with nanoparticles in the recording layer, and how to prepare quite efficient diffraction structures. So that's all, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much for this presentation. I have a question. Mm-hmm. Was it the silver halide particles that you embed in the polymer is 30 nanometer?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's... And are there any other question from the audience?
I have two questions. Sir. First of all, have you had a chance to do a study of the diffraction efficiency as a function of spatial frequency of the grating? Because I would imagine that you might find that you might get some optimal performance with different spatial frequencies. The second question is, have you studied the diffraction efficiency, I'm sorry, the sensitivity, how sensitive it is, and over what wavelengths is it sensitive?
Yeah, so I will start with the second question. The sensitivity of the material is about from 5 to 10 millijoules per square centimeters. It is designed for green wavelength, but if you use a different photoinitiator, you can shift it to red or to blue wavelength as well. It depends on the photoinitiator, and they are available also for other wavelengths. Okay? And we studied the dependence on the spatial frequency. I think it is this graph, and you can see that there is a limit for the resolution. That if we have the spatial frequency about 300 nanometers, then the refractive index modulation is low. So it is not suitable so far for the reflection holograms. It is just for transmission. But surprisingly, it works quite.